May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer.
Amen.
Please be seated. Well, good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Rob O'Neill. It's my privilege to serve as the Bishop of the Diocese of Colorado, a particular vocation I have had the privilege of inhabiting for 10 years now. And it's particularly a pleasure to be here with all of you in the Episcopal Diocese of Fort Worth this evening. And I can only begin by saying a word of thanks. First, thanks to Bishop High for the invitation to be here. I can't tell you how much I value Bishop High's friendship and companionship and collegial fellowship in this one ministry that we all share. He is a gift and a blessing to me personally, and I know that he is a gift and a blessing to you all too. And so thank you, Raybu, for the invitation. And thanks to all of you here in this diocese for allowing me the privilege of occupying a little space of this gathering and participating with you in this assembly of the diocese. I know that as a diocesan body gathered in this particular configuration, this thing that we call a diocesan convention, I know that you have important work to do, which has already begun this afternoon, which will continue on into tomorrow. And if you are like any of the other dioceses of which I have been a part of over the 32 years I have been ordained, I know that when we gather in this particular configuration and those issues of our organizational life, those issues of our institutional life, which I prefer to say are really matters of how we choose to live in community as sisters and brothers in Christ, I know nonetheless that dealing with all those issues of governance and leadership and so on, I know that there is inevitably a corresponding rise in anxiety or boredom when those things are brought up. But I bring you greetings from your sisters and brothers in the Diocese of Colorado, 114 congregations spread across 105,000 square miles of the Diocese of Colorado, of all shapes and sizes and configurations. I bring you greetings from them, and I want to tell you, I think it's really good that we're just here, literally here, gathered around this altar right now. Because here at the Lord's table, where we have the opportunity to simply offer ourselves, our souls, our bodies. Gathered here at this table, this is, so far as I can tell, where life begins. This is where we offer ourselves into the service of that kingdom where absolute love reigns absolutely, the kingdom of God. It's good that we're here. And you know, our work, whenever we gather here, and frankly, our work at all times, is first and foremost always an act of remembrance. Those are the words we hear week in and week out. Remember, remember, remember. Our work is always primarily a work of remembrance, allowing ourselves to be recalled by grace to our deepest identity, to who we really are, who God creates us to be, even here, even now. As my favorite Franciscan writer Richard Rohr says, if we get the who right, the rest will follow. I'll say that one again. You can write it down, you can take it to the bank, it works. If we get the who right, the rest will follow. If you've heard the readings from Scripture this evening, you know that they speak very directly to our collective identity. To a displaced and dispossessed people who believe that they have lost their value, their worth, their purpose in God's eyes. To those people, Ezekiel says that divine possibility is being brought out of their loss and out of their suffering, saying that even through this, God is putting in you a new heart and a new spirit, which will lead you into a new relationship with and a new purpose with the rest of the world. To Nicodemus, a Pharisee, one who seems to recognize the divine presence in Jesus, Jesus speaks to him of the need to be born of the Spirit in order to see the kingdom of God. And Paul, of course, in the letter to the Romans, to this fledgling community, the faithful in Rome, who must inevitably wondering who they are, this little body in the overwhelming heart of this huge empire, to this body, he says, you are children of God because you are born of the Spirit, because you have been adopted by grace, because you have the ability to call God Abba, Father. This is the deep reality of our life, our core identity, if you will, that whether we know it or not, whether we accept it or reject it, whether we claim it or deny it, the living Spirit of the living God lives within us, moves dynamically among us, has the capacity to transform life, renewing our life, raising all life up, bringing all things to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, to refer to that wonderful collect out of the prayer book. That's just who we are, the Spirit of God inevitably moving through all of us. This is who God is, this is what love looks like, this is how God works, and it's who we are. Now, you may or may not know this, but I stand before you this evening really as a product of this body, as one who has been given life from this body of Christ in the Diocese of Fort Worth. And I do want to tell you a piece of that story, if you will indulge me this evening. This is not intended just to be autobiographical and a walk down memory lane, because in the end, I think that this story really isn't my story. It's our story. This is how God has worked, does work, and continues to work among us. I can tell you this. I did not grow up in the Episcopal Church. I was baptized at St. Mark's Church in Altadena, California, at the age of 4. I remember some pieces of my baptism, but the fact that I was baptized at the age of 4 tells you something about my parents' spiritual discipline. After I was baptized, my parents divorced shortly thereafter, and after that, we never darkened the door of a church after that. On the few occasions that my mother dragged me to go to church along with my brother, I can remember only that the sermons seemed interminably long. And I can remember, too, that these clergy who stood at the door wearing robes, bending over me as a child with big, broad smiles on their faces, I remember that I took a very dim view of the clergy in my childish, cynical mind. I said, these guys are paid to smile. You can't trust them. And yes, I was a cynical child. Eventually, I came to Texas Christian University. I went to TCU for one very good reason. The girl I was dating decided to go to TCU. So I threw in an application at the last moment. Somehow I was accepted, and shortly thereafter I found myself standing in the middle of the campus with a suitcase in one hand and a typewriter in the other. Yes, a typewriter. A typewriter in the other, in the middle of a place I had never set foot in before and never seen. I studied physics. That's another story. I'll tell you over dinner. Not long into my first semester, I was sitting at my desk late one afternoon. I was hungry. I wanted to have dinner, but I didn't want to eat alone. I didn't know too many people. I looked out the window. I saw a guy walking across the quad in the general direction of the dining hall. And so I got up and ran down three flights of stairs, and I caught up to him, and I introduced myself to him, and we went and we had dinner. His name was Russell C. Cushman from Nacogdoches, Texas. After dinner, we went across the street to a bar called Fat Al's. That is the name of the bar. And we had a few beers because it was Nicola Beer Night. And in those days, the drinking age was somewhat younger than it is now. And somewhere during that conversation at Fat Al's, Russ started to talk about religion. And so I said to him, rather cynically, well, if you're so damn religious, how come you're sitting here in a bar having beers with me? And without missing a beat, Russ said, well, that one is easy. I'm an Episcopalian. That is an exact quote. I'm not writing this stuff up. He might as well have said that he was a Martian, because it was a word I did not know, and it had way too many syllables in it. But two things seemed to be going on in that moment. Russ was a very committed Christian. He was a product of the charismatic renewal movement. Russ had an evangelical heart, and he spoke freely about the reality and the liveliness of the Holy Spirit in his life, and about his relationship with somebody named Jesus. For my part, I was a young adult who had come from Los Angeles to Texas simply to get out of Dodge, so to speak. But at the same time, I was actually asking significant life questions. Things like, I wonder what it really means to be a human being. Or things like, I wonder what this life is anyway. What does give life weight and heft and substance and force and direction and intention and creativity and life? What really has the capacity, I wondered, to make a difference? Is there anything that really has the capacity to heal, to transform what looked to me as a young adult to be a pretty broken world? So when Russ invited me to go to church with him one Sunday, I simply accepted. At best, I thought, maybe I should give a little attention to this religion thing and see what it's about. And Russ didn't just invite me to go to church. He talked about his experience and his relationship with God. He raised questions, really irritating and very basic questions. Things like, so who do you think Jesus is? Great question. Or, what do you think it really means to be a disciple, to follow Jesus? Or have you ever experienced the liveliness of the Holy Spirit moving within you, or among you, or within somebody else? Is that a part of your experience? And then, just to make it even worse, Russ would occasionally throw a pamphlet in my direction, which made me totally nervous. And when he wasn't around, I would actually pick them up and I would read them, because I was taking it in and I was thinking about it. I would pick them up and I would read them, and I kept going to Trinity Episcopal Church in Fort Worth, Texas, right across South University Boulevard, every Sunday with Russell C. Cushman from Navasota, Texas. I'll tell you, one Sunday I went forward to receive communion, and as I knelt at the altar rail, I looked at this plain stone wall behind the altar. I don't know what it looks like now, but it was plain. I just looked up at it. And I knelt there at the altar rail, and for reasons I don't fully understand, I just felt this prayer forming, welling up within me. God, I said, I don't even know if you exist. But if you do, here I am. That was it. That was the extent of that prayer. It was really the most honest I possibly could have been in that moment with God. And I know it's the most honest I could have been with myself in that moment. Totally open. Just surrender. And desire, an inarticulate longing, even hunger for something more transcendent. Today, I would tell you that that is the fundamental posture of prayer. I know that to be the posture of the boy Samuel in the temple. Here I am, Lord. I know that to be the posture of Mary when overwhelmed by the divine presence of the angel Gabriel. Total surrender. Here I am. Let it be to me according to your word. No holds barred abandonment. In love, to love, for love. And there I was. God, I don't even know if you exist. But if you do, here I am. Well, the priest came by, the rector came by with the host, and he placed it in my hand. And he said, the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. And the chalice minister, there's another word I didn't know. The chalice minister came by with the cup and gave it to me and said, the blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Those words have become now like familiar friends. But in that moment, I can tell you, in ways I can't explain to you, they took on weight, force, depth, substance. They went right into the depth of my soul. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven, the blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. And this is what I knew, that this is real. Really real. As C.S. Lewis might say, the deep magic of our life. And I realized in that moment that religion, this God thing, wasn't just one piece of life among many others to which I might attend on occasion, but I knew somehow, without having even words for it, I knew somehow that this was the very source of all life, that from which all things come. It was a significant turning point for me, to say the least. It was like being brought back to myself. It was like discovering again, but for the first time, who I am created to be, who all of us are created to be, and that new and divine possibilities would be coming forth. Oh yeah, you know, once Jesus told Nicodemus that the Spirit of God is like the wind. It simply blows where it wills. And so it does. This Holy Spirit that binds us all together, that draws us together even here, even now, inevitably drawing us into life in ways we can't even begin to imagine or manage or control. The wind does blow where it wills, but it does blow. And that's the thing to remember, that it does blow. 40 years ago in my life, the Spirit of God moved mysteriously through Russell C. Cushman, just one individual, a freshman at TCU from Nacogdoches, Texas, who simply offered to me what he had. 40 years ago, the Spirit of God moved through the good people of Trinity Church in Fort Worth. Just one congregation who somehow understood that just across the street there was a whole university, a whole community of young adults asking significant life questions, hungering, yes, hungering for the real deal, longing to make a difference. This community of Trinity just offering themselves, being who they are, what they had. They folded me and others like me into their life. They challenged me to learn, to explore the faith and to grow in faith. They invited me to engage in ministry and gave me a variety of ways to contribute my gifts in meaningful ways to a common life that was much greater than any of us individually. And in 1973, I was confirmed there by A. Donald Davies. And shortly thereafter, I was sponsored by Trinity for ordination. Oh, how the divine and life-giving Spirit of God moves in and through our very ordinary and uneven lives is quite the mystery. But the Spirit does move. The Spirit does move. Freely, graciously, generously, abundantly, within us and among us. Even here. Even right now. With whatever we have. This is who you are. This is who I am. Who we all are collectively. So as you move through this annual convention of this diocese, remember, 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 remember. Remember that our work is not primarily propping up an aging institution or managing an organization. Remember. Remember, our work always has been and always will be simply to offer whatever we have, and let God do the rest. Remember that in the midst of all the details and anxieties of this life, We need only open the window. Offer whatever we have. Let the breeze blow through and stand back to see what new and divine possibilities God will raise up within us and among us for the sake of that kingdom where absolute love reigns absolutely. Amen. Amen.